There are quite a lot, but for time purposes, I think when it comes to the food aspect, these are some of the things that we need to look at. But if you permit me, we can go into other forms of allergies or things that can provoke allergies that most of the time parents don't put their mind to.
Okay.
So, for instance, you live in an environment where there are animals or pets. Most of us will have cats and dogs as our pets, all right? What happens that these animals, what they do that they leave their salivas, their fur, their skin, in various things surrounding us, in our carpets, in our upholsteries. Sometimes some of them will even climb into the beddings of the children, all right? And so if your child is allergic to any of those things in there, like the fur or the saliva of the cat or dog, it means you are creating an environment for the child to keep suffering. All right? Sometimes the cats and dogs jump on our furniture, on our carpets, and they need some of these, we call them dunders, in there. And so the child also plays around the same environment. Then each day, each night, say, oh, my child is having running nose, my child is itchy, my child is not able to sleep. It's because the child is probably living in an environment that the child is reacting to something in there. And that is why, as parents, you should always be careful or be a bit more on the lookout when our children have allergies so that you would want to take steps to be able to identify some of these things that we are talking about. Right, so this is what we call the animal allergy, for instance, where they leave some of these things. And of course, we can also have the mold. The mold allergy where, because we create an environment where molds are able to thrive in our basements or in places where they are mostly very swampy and cold and things like that. These molds can also be some of the things that children can react or can be allergic to. But because we don't put our mind to it, or it doesn't occur to us, they keep going around such areas. In our bathrooms or in our kitchens, those molds are there. And those molds bring out, they bring out or spores that tend to circulate in the environment. So the child might just get into the environment and inhale it. All right, and leads to the reaction, and you see most allergic reactions are very similar. As I mentioned, the eye might be tearing, the nose might be running, the skin might be itching, the throat might be itching. For those very devastating ones, the big swellings, and then if you are not careful, the anaphylactic state can also set in. There are others. We could talk about, let's say, the people being allergic to grass. Okay? So the child goes to school in a very nice grassy environment and almost always returns to the home setting with all manner of skin rashes and things like that. Alright? You, the parent, you would want to find out what's happening. We think of the school setting is the best of place, or it's tiled. They just have a small garden here where they allow the kids to play in. But it could well be that the child is actually reacting to the grass there. So, and that one, it can be quite immediate, or it can last an hour before it happens. So the child can actually have the skin rashes develop then and then after touching the grass, or some hours after. So that then, what happens is that the child, maybe the reaction might not happen in the school setting, but returns home or the way to home, then it happens, then it becomes difficult for parents to really identify why it happened, because then they wouldn't have thought that, okay, maybe something that the child may have been exposed to in their school setting. You get it? And so it's always important for parents to have some of this in their mind. Pollens. Okay, so for instance, if the child finds him or herself in an environment where there are plants or trees, that produces some pollens that tends to, you know, cause problems. But you know, pollens can also travel several miles. So you could be maybe 10 meters away from a plant that is producing the kind of pollen that can actually, a child can react to. But you will not know. And so you can say, oh, he didn't get close enough. But it's not, because it is in the air, then it majorly gets to where the child is. Then the reaction starts. So there are a variety of things that, I mean, there are plants and pollens and you name it. Variety of things that children can actually react to. So it is always important for parents to be always on the lookout, alert. And then the other thing that I thought that she mentioned, egg, is also the second commonest thing that, you know, children tend to react to. Yes, it really can harm them. And some of them, of course, some of them, they will outgrow it. Or as they are growing, it would eventually fade away. Their reaction may fade away. But it is one of the things that we need to look at. And don't let them say, oh, I want to try if my child reacts to either the yolk or the white part. Once the child has laid egg, you would want to avoid both as much as possible. Do you get it? And so, I don't know whether you want me to answer some other questions.
Sure. And what are some of the things parents can do? I mean, some basic steps to identify what their children are allergic to.
Okay, so probably before I say that, I answer that, we would also want to look at some of the common things that I probably should let parents know. You know, we have dust mites.
Okay.
You know, dust mites is also one of the things that children, it tends to harm them a lot. And it's also because, you know, children live amongst us and we do a lot of activities around them, like the vacuuming and the sweeping and then dusting. If a child is allergic to a dust mite, once you do all those activities in the home setting, which we are bound to do anyway,
yes,
then it means that he would want to, like, he exposes the child to the dust mites, and then the reaction will start, alright?
Yeah.
And so, it is one of the things that we also need to look at. And then there are also insects, you know, insects that can cause problems. Cockroaches can be one of the insects that can cause allergies to children. So we have to be mindful that in a home setting, we wouldn't create a situation where, you know, cockroaches will thrive, because, and mostly, you know, they cause harm mostly at night.
Yes.
And so you want to ensure that they don't thrive, or you don't breed them in an environment, because that might just be the reason why your child has some form of, you know, itches and the nose and dripping and what have you, which means that the child might be reacting to those insects. And then now back to your question about the steps that parents can take to avert it. This is a tough one. It is always a miserable to face. And so sometimes it will require a lot of diligence. Which sometimes, yes, some parents might make the effort, but it might not necessarily be enough. Because you see, it's also not the case that as an individual or as a child, you might just be allergic to one thing. There could be multiple things that you might be allergic to. So when it happens that way, it becomes in a bit more difficult. But even that, we still believe that if a parent wants to put his or her mind to finding out the reasons why a child has some form of allergies, parents can do so. So we encourage parents to be on the lookout. So you say, for instance, you had your child had a reaction of a sort, either skin rashes or, you know, severe abdominal pain, or after taking a particular meal. So when you come to our consultation, for instance, we will ask you what the child is eating, some maybe 24 hours prior to all happening. things that we want parents also to be doing. Ask yourself questions. Could it be that the party that my child attended, maybe that the pineapple juice that he took at this time, then you document it. All right, you write it down that, okay, I'm suspecting pineapple, or I'm suspecting peanut, or I'm suspecting rice, or I'm suspecting this base, that, they get it.
Yeah.
And as I said, you shouldn't take chances and say, oh, this is a common thing everybody eats. No. We are very different, and we are very, when it comes to this, it's very, very individual. So, you document that. Now you document that, should the child have similar reactions at another point in time, then you look at your list. Okay, looks like after he took this, that, or base, or feed, or shrimps, it has appeared twice in my list. So there's a likelihood that the child could be allergic to shrimp. But as I said, you shouldn't just say, oh, he's allergic to shrimp, and that is done. No, the child could be allergic to several other things. It will have his food allergies, it will have his animal allergies, it will have his pollen allergies. So you should be able to, and that's what it requires a lot of diligence work. You like spyware, where yes, you need to be particular and watching, be watchful. Then as you eliminate the possible reasons or possible allergens, then you'll be making progress. Of course, when you come to us, you will have some tests and things to do to identify some of those things. But even those ones, because they are not done in vivo, alright?
Yeah.
You will always want to be sure. When I say in vivo, it's not done in the end user, but it's a sample that is taken and done in the laboratory. Alright? So there might well be a situation where what the laboratory tells you is not exactly what happens in the individual, and vice versa. Do you get it?
Yes.
And that's why it's always appropriate for you, the parent, to be very particular as to what you are looking out for. And then, once you are able to, you know, like in the real life, identify the things, you are better out than depending on the laboratory setup.
So with that being said, what can parents also do to prevent allergies?
Well, prevention is like, just like we discussed, is trying to be able to identify. Once you are able to identify why your child is having this particular reaction or that particular reaction, then you want to avoid the child having those meals or getting closer to those environments or ensuring that the cats are not anywhere near the child, or you always ensure that when you are, let's say, vacuuming or sleeping, the child is nowhere near there. Do you get it?
Yeah.
And it's about you identifying the cause, then avoiding the child getting anywhere close to those environments. And that will be the key. Of course, as I said, there could be some medications that will mitigate the effect of your child's allergies, but your best bet will always be when you are able to identify the parasitic agent and avoid them.
Alright. So in the event that there's an allergic reaction, is there any form of treatment that can be given?
Yeah. As I said, you know, normally the allergies, your body produces a substance we call the histamine, and that's what causes most of the harm to the body itself, the individual itself. Your immune system is trying to respond to an aggression, and you are the one suffering, you know, as an individual. And so normally, there are various medications on the market, like the antihistamines, which would eventually help to subside or avoid the progression of the reaction. But it also depends on the location of the reaction. Okay, so sometimes in the case of, you know, the eczemas, and this is some topical medication can also be applied, depends on the severity of the condition. And then for those that, if you are not careful, their allergies can spur them into becoming asthmatics. But there are those conditions also. And that's why it's always imperative to go to identify them early. Otherwise, especially when there is a family history of allergies or asthmatics, and the child is being exposed continually to those allergens, you are not careful, you push the child to become asthmatic. Okay. And so yes, people who have allergies, some can become asthmatics as a lot of the things they are allergic to.
Okay, Doc, so what is the final advice you have for our viewers concerning allergies?
Well, as we discussed, it's all about, you know, being vigilant and prevention one, prevention two, and prevention three.
Thank you very much. This has been a very informative session. I hope you enjoyed our session with Dr. B, and stay tuned for our next video.